get really sleepy. So I got the 4 o'clock slot here, so I hope you either ate a lot of ice cream or caffeinated yourself beforehand. So we'll just start talking. This is the synopsis that you prop up in your bed that made you show up here. And I just wanted to highlight this talk and show you how we use this to fill medium scale needs at Odom College. Why am I not talking the higher education track? It's happening tomorrow. The reason is that I have to pick up a small person at camp who hasn't cleaned his socks in about a month probably, so I can't be here. I just want to thank Kelly and the other camp organizers for allowing me to talk today instead of tomorrow. It would have made sense for me to talk. This isn't a technical talk. I'm not going to talk to you about how to deploy WordPress MU, but I would be happy to share any limited knowledge that I have about it. I've gone to a number of conferences, including WP Campus, where people, including Boston University last year, talked a lot about how they have done this on really a massive scale. There's a lot of really impressive stuff going on about how to keep code up to date and the like out there. So I would definitely encourage looking at that. So what this is going to be is a showcase for the kind of stuff that falls in between the cracks of a learning management system and a content management system. All the different kinds of teaching and other things that go on that require people to have stuff that doesn't fit in a vision framework. So I hope this will be a good departure point for you. And with that, a little bit about me and the content management thread of why I'm standing up here. I got started in,
yes. Am I one of the speakers in my voting box?
Does this work better?
Yeah.
Okay. A little bit about me and why I'm here. I got started in web stuff in the 90s back at Disney Online. Back then we were working on stuff that we were literally building monthly and daily websites by hand. It drove all of us crazy. There was a whole team of us who were building things with HTML. At that point, the management was smart enough to bring on some of the best engineers that I've ever worked with. There were a bunch of Next Step engineers. Just before they were bought by Apple, and they built some homegrown CMS stuff that was just out of this world. And actually, some of it is still being used to this day, 20-some-odd years later. From there, I went on to the agency world. I went to YNR, US Web, ZKS, and March 1st. When I was there at YNR, we did a little bit of CMS stuff where we would build out of ASP forms that would literally post one news release for clients. And we would charge somewhere in the neighborhood of about $30,000 to do that. It seemed a little bit crazy. After that, at US Web CKS on March 1st, I did some large-scale e-commerce CMS stuff, ETG Dynamo, which is a product that came out of the Media Lab at MIT originally. And then the last dozen or so years, I've been working at Odom College. When I got to Odom College, we had a very bedraggled content management system that was homegrown. We later moved to a larger product which we're still using. And there have been, and I worked with a number of people who were very smart, including someone who told me that I really needed to try movable type. And as you can see from the bottom right, this is my first post in WordPress in 2005. And I thank my colleague Robert for guiding me to blogging software, and I would have taken his advice to use movable type, but my ISP had fantastic help. With one button, I could try WordPress, and from there I got hooked. What is WordPress multi-site? Again, I won't go into the technicalities of what it is, but essentially what it does is it allows you to take one set of code base and become kind of a mini ISP. And so you can either set it up so that it's your domain and then the name of the site, or the make them as subdomains. You have to choose one or the other when you get off the ground. And you can see that the admin control panel shows you all of those different things. So let's get into some of the problems that we were trying to solve at college. Our student organizations needed web hosting. When I got there, they used to have a system where everyone basically got a drive and a folder on a web server and they had to just dump stuff into. Content was very varied, It required a knowledge of HTML. Most of the kids used Dreamweaver at the time. Other people used other stuff. But it was kind of a mess. And one of the reasons it was a mess was because they would share passwords. There would be one shared password for everybody. They would always lose it. Kids would graduate, move on, and nobody would get anything done. So they didn't know how to, who was doing what. And it was just kind of a mess. The solution is we set up a version of MU on it called students.odin.edu. Obviously very easy to learn how to publish. It's WordPress. We were able to use LDAP, and now we use Active Directory authentication so that when a student graduates, they can't post there anymore. So we don't really have to worry about somebody off campus with a password that's passed on to them, and they were the president of the whatever club 4 years ago still doing it. Generally, the way we like to do things is that we have one administrator and usually about three authors or editors. Instead of making everybody an administrator, usually you end up with trouble because if you put everybody in charge, then nobody's in charge. And if there's a problem, which there usually aren't a lot of problems, or if a kid needs to figure out how to do widgets or theme work or the like, we have one point of contact. And it's obviously easy enough with WordPress roles to switch it back and forth. So if one kid wants to do it for a semester and the other kid wants to do it for another semester, it's super easy. We do make exceptions for almost everything, but this is the basic way we set things up. The list on the front page of the site, as you can see on the bottom, is not really alphabetical. We use a plugin from WPMU Dev. It's called Blogs Directory, and what it does is that it just puts at the top whoever's been posting most recently. And this is a nice tool for us, too, because we see people float all the way down to the bottom and haven't updated their sites in a couple of years. And sometimes that's because they forget, and sometimes it's because the club has kind of gone inactive. Students come and go, and some years there are a lot of kids who are fencing, and some years there aren't. And so at that point, we can deactivate them and reactivate them when people need that. We give them only a number of themes, and the reason is that when we first started doing it, we would give them about 60 or 70 themes to choose from. And that was a pretty early on in WordPress, so things would break frequently because we put in, frankly, some pretty cruddy themes. And the other problem is that they would spend all of their time changing themes. And so the Spanish club, for instance, would have a different theme every other day, but it would never have any sort of post about when the meeting was. And so we knocked it down to about half a dozen themes, and we made sure that they're child themes, so they have Google Analytics in them. And if people need something different or something special, I'll show you that in a moment, we're happy to accommodate them. But we kind of ended up by giving them too many choices, we set them up for failure. So this is the rowing club, pretty standard looking website. And then this is a kind of a little small cornucopia. The top left is the student government. They got a special website because they're a very, very active group. They had somebody who was knowledgeable, and they passed it by us what it is that they wanted to use beforehand. The top right is the same kind of circumstance with Miscellanea. They're one of the many acapella groups that's at Bowdoin. The bottom left is a really plain vanilla, or a plain lemon and custard if you want, for the bike club. They just needed something really straight up. And even more vanilla is the Straight Alliance on the right. They didn't want any fancy graphics. They just wanted the real basics of what it is and what they did. And frequently we find that there are students who are not that web savvy who take over a club like that and just want something really simple. They don't want to deal with it. And then another kid who gets more involved will take off and let it go. Okay, moving on to the academic side of the house. The learning management system we have at Bowdoin is this Blackboard, and it really doesn't meet the needs of all of our professors. Blackboard is pretty much a closed system. And prior to using Blackboard, one of the things that Bowdoin professors did a lot of was post their syllabi online. They really wanted to be able to share with other colleagues around the world the kinds of things that they were teaching and also give students or perspective to the college and glimpse at the kind of things that they could expect when they were coming. Blackboard isn't very flexible, it's not good at handling images, it's not good at blogging, and it's generally a pretty clunky product. You know, that said, it does what it's supposed to do, and it's very good for class rosters and grading and other kinds of things like that. So it shouldn't be written off entirely, but it doesn't really fill all the So the solution was, is we put up a site called courses.bowdoin.edu. And it has options for public and private things. And the reason for that is that, again, some people really want their stuff to be out there in public. I'll show you one in a moment. And other people want things to be in private. For instance, if you're a visual arts class and you're having to pick the kids, students that is, post images that are clearly in somebody else's copyright in order to do an exercise, you gotta keep it behind a firewall. It's obviously fair use to use them, but it's not really a great idea to have them out in the front. And the other ones, when things are a little bit more about writing, is that some of the students feel a little bit bashful about having their assignments really kind of out in public, and the professors are also cognizant of that and want to be able to make them feel free about having using WordPress as a forum, but not having it out there. Another thing that faculty like to do is have students use WordPress to do assignments. If you think back 10 or so years ago, when kids got out of college, one of the things they would do is they would put it on their resume that they knew how to use Excel, they knew how to use Word, they knew how to use PowerPoint and the like. At this point, that's pretty standard fare. And so when you get out of school, even though Bowdoin is a liberal arts college, it's not a very tech-booky kind of place, be able to know how to do content management using software like WordPress is a good thing to do. It easily handles media, and we've used the iOS app, I'll show you one in a moment, to do some photo stuff. Really quick and easy to spin down. And one note on it is because this is an in-between service at the school, it took us a long time to get our IT organization comfortable with us using it. We had some of the same fears that many did a number of years ago, so we agreed with them that it was going to be a pilot, and we let it go for a couple of years. It wasn't a core service. We did have some trouble with databases early on, but for the last 6 or 7 years, it's really been rock solid. So this is an example of an education class where if you look up on the right side of this one on the left, you see the list of all the students. And so essentially each student did their term paper as a little mini website for this class. And it isn't anything that's, you know, super fancy in terms of website development or design, but you can see that these two students on the right, they changed the background color, they put in a different header, they learned about organization, they learned about menus and submenus, and it was really a good start for a lot of the kids. Most of the kids don't go on and do anything exceptional with it. They've learned the skill, but out of most of the classes, one or two kids get really excited and gets going on either WordPress or other kinds of web technology, so that gets me excited. This was a trip to Sicily that a couple of classes took last year, and every kid who had either an Android or an iPhone took it with them, and there were a couple of kids who didn't have either, so we lent them iPod Touches that had cameras and Wi-Fi that they could use back at the hotel at night, and they went about their trip and saw some pretty incredible things and were able to relay it back in real time. And then some of them went back in and did a little bit of editing to make it look a little bit nicer, but it's really a nice record of the trip and to show other kids in the future what kind of stuff they could do. On the left here is another travel blog. This was just done over the summer. A bunch of students went to Japan to do some environmental stuff, and they took advantage, you can see in the right hand, of authors and calendars and categories and tags and recent posts and just kind of all the basic stuff around WordPress. On the right, this is an English class where the teacher had 8 or 9 different assignments, and each student was required to post on that assignment, and then the other students were able to kind of comment and go back and forth a little bit on it. This was a closed one that's not open to the public, and they enjoyed being able to do this in more of a real-time fashion. On the left, this is an exhibition that was done at the Bowdoin College Museum of Art. And it was a student-curated exhibition with a professor who was trying to get some stuff online of which there isn't really a lot of material. And so, a combination of the students curating the exhibition, putting the exhibition up, And at the top right, you see a catalog entry for that particular work on paper. And again, these are things that just prior to us putting this out there, if you Googled it, there really wasn't that much information on these specific artists and some of these specific pieces. So that was really part of the aim. On the bottom right is a very, very simple but effective use of it as a alternative to Blackboard. The computer science people at the college are very, very concerned with having their stuff out there. Part of their discipline, and I think part of their branding, is that their syllabi are out there, their course descriptions, and what they do. They really, really cooperate with other people at other institutions, and frequently, I believe in this one, there are links to other people's lessons, and the other people link back to them. And so this was a real good solution for that. This was an image gallery for a visual arts course. Again, you can see that these are things that clearly not copyright kosher. There's a Doc Edgerson picture, there's the Beatles hitting each other with pillows up there, all sorts of stuff. But the students could respond to the request of the professor and either put these up, or you can see on the right side some of the other block themes are photos that they took of themselves really quickly so that the other students could also see and they could come into class and do a critique quite easily. This is another exhibition that was done at the museum that the students did, and this survived as a record of what happened. And also, we get students who just show up and want to do an independent study or something for their professor. And this one is a writing creative project that was about a fictitious antique booth at a mill down the street from college. Another thing that we addressed was that research is obviously going online. There are less and less academic journals out there, and projects that people are doing are starting to encapsulate digital humanities. So some of their research questions and scholarship simply needed a place to find online. At one point we had, like with our student organizations, we had a place where people could just dump stuff. We installed some Drupal over there, we installed some Joomla, we installed a couple of WordPress instances, but it really ended up being a big mess, and so we decided to try to go to this. This is an example of a professor of Italian who takes things about Dante in contemporary culture and posts them in a number of different categories. She and her colleague at Stanford seek them out, but they also have people send them in, and they get all sorts of crazy things from, you know, Dante flavor of seventh hell food, to movies, to music, to clothing. It's pretty amazing the scope that this site has and how much reach it has. It really gets a decent amount of traffic. This was one that was done, a research project with someone in gender and women's studies, about 40 years of Bowdoin women. It just happened a couple of years ago. It was divided, as you can see, into six different categories. Under each of the categories, there were students who did research on oral histories, on primary source documents in our archives, and a number of other things. And this was really a super obvious vehicle for WordPress, which is very good at categories and tags and other sorts of taxonomies. This is a project that's ongoing with a professor in art history that adds a geospatial dimension. You can see there's a map there. They're color-coded by the different states. And this is about something called a punka. And you can see the illustrations down below. These were ceiling-mounted fans in the antebellum United States. And people would pull on a string or on a piece of wood, and a little fan would come down in your hot environment. It was your air conditioning, and it got rid of the flies, I think, too. So one of the nice things about this as a scholarly pursuit is that it's not frozen in time. And she's able to continue researching. People send in information to her, or she finds information out there in the world, and she can keep adding on to the fans. If she ends up making a book out of it, she makes a book out of it. But this way, it lives in a very different kind of way. This is a very plain vanilla one that we did for a psychology professor. We did one for him that was kind of fancy, and I think it had a slider and other things you're not supposed to have, but it looked really fancy, nice. He does these temperament questionnaires about infants and early adolescents, and they are translated into an incredible number of languages, and people from around the world who are studying psychology request them from him. And so really what this is that we have a form, and it does data collection, and then it sends out a PDF with a Word doc to whoever you are. And at the end of the year, he has a database, and he can figure out who's asking for what, and in what languages, and from where they're coming. And we do some pretty straight up WordPress-y kind of things, like on the lawn for the Marine Laboratory. And as you can see on the right, they use a mailing list, and it's scraped by MailChimp and sends out an RSS emailing every once in a while. A couple other notes. One of the things that we really try to do is to try to name everything really, really logically. So if you were doing an Italian course in the fall of 2018, the name of the site on our site is Italian 3072 Fall 2018. We really try to make sure that people don't use any sort of acronyms for things. And, you know, so the Bowdoin Bike Club is not the BBC, it's the Bowdoin-Bike-Club. It helps on a lot of different levels. It helps me when I'm trying to figure out what it is 3 years later, if somebody else is trying to work on it, it's helpful. And the reality is that acronyms in insider baseball are no good for anybody. For the sites that are spidered by Google, it helps them too. So the default for settings on almost everything is that we do discourage the search engines, and then from there we decide with the professor or with the students if they do things that they want to be out there. We do use some plugins I'll talk about in a moment that hide things completely from the outside world. And occasionally, we have a firewall system called the F5, where we will have the system administrators just absolutely block things from off campus, so it becomes an intranet. One of the things that you'll notice, and one of the challenges that I heard at WP campus last year, is that a lot of people, when implementing WordPress academic environment, we're worried about were branding guidelines. And the problem seemed to come from the tension of when you have a really creative tool that can do all sorts of things, and you can flip things around, and you can put widgets over here, and things over there, and footers over there. That runs afoul of branding guidelines. And so you have this really flexible system, but you have a set of guidelines that's very, very, very rigid. So we purposely on this decided this is stuff that fell between the cracks and didn't need to have it. But we always have a link at the bottom that kind of goes back to the mothership. Okay, some of the important plugins for us, as you can see, this is, I think, the research site here. We've got about 63 plugins there. We really don't turn very many of them on in a network way. Akismet, as you can say, is. But we've just been adding them over the years. Authentication, we use something for Active Directory. Akismet is something that you absolutely must use if you're doing any commenting. We don't do a lot of commenting sites, because as any of you who run a site that has commenting, you know that it can go down a rabbit hole really quickly and ugly. We pay WPMU Dev to use their stuff. We have a subscription. We use a lot of it. The two that we use most on these is multi-site privacy, and that allows you to make whatever site that is completely private, private to people with a password, private to users of the entire subdomain, user, all sorts of different levels, and we found that to be very helpful. And then the other one of new blog templates is quite helpful in that we set up kind of a really plain thing with the things that we like and the permalink structure and how we want images to be treated and the no search on, all those things. And so it makes it really good for us to be able to spin things up super quickly. I like to use user switching. It lets me troubleshoot things with the user. They call me up and they say, I can't see such and such a menu. if the user's switching, I can switch over to be them, and then I can say, well, actually, you need to look over to the left, or, oh, I'm sorry, I forgot to turn that on for you. We use Genesis, and I'll talk about that in a moment, frameworks, quite a lot, and for them, we use Simple Edits, which allows us to do some pretty basic things, including a nice little spot for putting in Google Analytics, a print style plus, which is for when people want to print out the web pages, and Simple Looks, which is just a nice part of Genesis Studio Press. Jetpack, obviously, has a lot of bang for the buck in it, so we turn that one on for people. There's always a light box. There's a lot of different flavors that are available, or you can use Carousel and Jetpack. And with the student ones, there's a nice little plugin that we really like to use called CC Child Pages. And what it does for people who are not professional web developers, if they have a category and then they have a lot of a subcategory, they end up really not having much of a landing page. And so what this does is that it takes anything that's a subpage and kind of lays it out for them. And so say you have 10 subpages on a certain category, it will make little blurbs for each of them there. And it really kind of helps the students start to figure out how to use user interface design. Plugins, keep them fresh. This happened to me last week, that one of the sites that we were using, actually that crew team site that I just showed you, they were using a plugin for team rosters, and we upgraded to 4.8, and the website disappeared. So one of our sysadmins sent me this and said, I think we need to deactivate that. So as you can see, with 63 different plugins in there, we try to go through and see if anything is really extraordinarily stale. We do get errors and keep our eyes open during upgrades. But with WordPress, it's really easy enough to kill them if they break with age or anything. Frequently, you can just deactivate them in the MU admin panel. But if not, if you have FTP access, you just rename it or delete it, and you're good to go. Themes. We use themes pretty much from two places. I'm a big believer in Genesis framework and StudioPress themes. It is a subscription, costs a couple $100, and you have access to a whole host of things. We've used them for years, so I'm very familiar with them. I'm very happy with them. I can do pretty much anything with them. Some of the best people in the business work on them. I'm not a paid shill. I actually paid them for their things. But the people, if you go look at who's working on the project, there's a number of people who you'll see at a lot of these different WordPress conferences, a lot of people who've worked on the core of WordPress. And they're very, very security-minded. They're very forward-thinking in terms of what they're doing with them. And we've just been super happy. It's a little bit small, but there's a link down there from WP Campus last year. Someone gave a really great talking about why you should use frameworks and why she also chose Genesis. And so it's really nice for me to go to a talk and hear somebody who validated what I was thinking and how we've been using things. We obviously use things that come in the WordPress theme directory. They are generally clean and good, and we do make exceptions if people come and ask us for stuff. We're not the kind of shop that says, no, you can only use what we want, as we told you so. We try to be as responsive to clients as possible. We obviously vet them to make sure that they're not just some random theme that came from somewhere and might have security bugs or might be coded poorly. Thanks. Any questions?
I think at the very beginning of your talk, you showed how you, what infrastructure you used to be able to deploy all these different sites, and I didn't catch the name of that.
I don't understand the question. What infrastructure we used to deploy the sites?
Well, and that would be very clear.
Okay, sorry.
All right, so whenever you want to create it, you showed a page that allowed
you made a set of multi-site.
Oh, for getting multi-site set up. When you're setting up WordPress, it's simply just an option at this point. There's a little button that you click, and then you make the decision of whether you're going to be using them as the subdomain, so the name of the site, dot, whatever your domain is, or it's the name of the domain, slash, whatever the name of the site is. and from there you just go. And so it used to be a little more complicated. You'd have to go into the wp-config and say configure multi-site yes, and do a little bit of this and a little bit of that. What it's actually called, it used to be called WordPress MU, multi-user, and now I believe it's called multi. They've changed what it's called a couple of times, and right now they basically pretend that it is just WordPress with the box checked, which it kind of is. My understanding is that WordPress.com has millions and millions and millions of sites, runs much in the same way, that it's just one code base, and then it runs out onto all sorts of other things. And as I kind of alluded to earlier, is that at a certain point, we had a whole bunch of different WordPress installs. So anytime somebody got the go-ahead to use WordPress for their academic project, we would just install it. And we ended up with about 20 installs, and we would forget they were there, and we wouldn't upgrade them, and at that point, we didn't have quite as strong of a firewall, so it was a security threat, and things would break, and it really seemed to be a very logical thing for us. One of the things that we don't do, that you can do, is domain mapping, where you can use one instance of WordPress MU, or multi-site, whatever it's called these days, and you can have it so that it doesn't say that particular domain, but it can be just suchandsuch.com or suchandsuch.edu, and just pointing things around. We just haven't used it. WPMU Dev has a really good plugin for that, and I've seen some people do some really impressive things.
So with all your students and faculty and researchers and all the people that are using WordPress, how do you do training at scale?
How do we train?
How do you train at scale so that you don't have people asking all the questions every single time, the same question?
Terrific question. I was just telling somebody the answer to this. How do we train people? When we first started using WordPress with students 10 years ago or so, I would generally go into the class and give a spiel for about half an hour. Every year that we've been using WordPress, it's gone down, and my spiel is now about 5 minutes. And there are a lot of reasons for that. I think that one of the reasons is that WordPress has gotten better. The interface has gotten easier. Students have gotten more familiar with it. It's very similar to posting on Facebook. And the reality is that with WordPress at whatever it is now, 28% of the internet, the resources are out there. So I would generally say, if you were a kid who I was teaching, I would say, you can come to my office anytime you want. Totally happy to help you. My door's open. But if you want to learn how to put an image into WordPress, Google it. And you're going to find 50 different videos and 10 different tutorials, and the resources are out there for you to do it. And so generally, I'll get a couple kids who get out of a class of, if both classes are small, say 20 kids, I'll generally get two kids who will come in and take advantage. And usually one of the kids is very computer inept and just wants someone to hold their hand. And then the other kid is like, oh my god, this thing is really cool. What else can I do with this? Show me plugins, and show me this, and show me that. So we have really found that it doesn't require a lot of